in charge of this prison. Well, speak up, my man.
I am a citizen.
My credentials. And while we were about it, why wasn't I met? Do you realize that I've walked through the whole of Paris without a guard? Me?
We would have arranged an escort had we been advised of your visit.
You were advised. I forward the communication myself. What if Robespierre hears about this?
Robespierre? I don't think you should worry the first deputy, citizen. He's a very busy man. I am at your service, citizen. Anything you wish to know?
Very well. Very well. Thank you. Yes, you seem a capable man, and I'm sure this misunderstanding is none of your doing.
Oh, indeed, citizen. I am most conscientious. But when you're assisted by idiots...
Of course, of course. And I'm glad we understand each other.
Excellent, citizen.
No, thank you.
I would deem it a privilege if I could be of help.
Thank you, citizen. It's all perfectly simple. Three traitors were brought here. A man, a woman, and a young child. They fled from my province. I'm sure you remember them.
Yes, sir.
Well, are they still here?
The women were dispatched to the guillotine. Unfortunately, there was a rescue.
What? By whom?
We don't know. Many times traitors have been snatched away on the road to the guillotine. You understand, of course, that I cannot be held responsible.
Yes.
They were outside my jurisdiction.
Yes, of course, of course. And the man, you haven't mentioned him.
No, well, the man,
But come along, out with it, man.
He escaped. He was a desperate fanatic, citizen. He gave me this wound. I fought with him, prepared to give my life to stop his escape. But he fought with the strength of 10 men.
Yes, 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 I believe what you say. I'm sure you did the best you could. It's a pity you're surrounded by such fools.
Exactly, citizen, exactly.
Yes, all three of them are somewhere in Paris.
They will be caught, you may rest assured.
Yes, yes. What?
Hello everyone, and welcome to an all-new episode of Doctor Who and Mr. Drew. It's your old time-traveling companion here, John S. Drew, and we've come to the end of the first series of Doctor Who from 1963. You know, it's interesting because, you know, we consider ourselves lucky these days to have 13 episodes that actually play out weekly a year, and that isn't always the case. Thanks, Stephen Moffat. Back then, though, a 55-year-old man with serious health issues was mostly involved in 41 half-hour episodes for this first series. And it's not going to slow down as we move into the second series. As much as Moffat and his team love to preen in front of the camera, showing themselves to be clever boys, I'll take William Hartnell's run of Doctor Who any day over any of the modern fare. And there is a lot to commend for the modern fare, but there's just something to be said for the days of William Hartnell and what they had to go through to put their series together. And this final story of the series is another great example. It's The Reign of Terror. This six-parter consisted of the episodes A Land of Fear, Guests of Madame Guillotine, A Change of Identity, The Tyrant of France, A Bargain of Necessity, and Prisoners of the Concierge. These episodes aired from August 8th to September 12th, 1964, written by Dennis Spooner, his first for the series, but certainly not his last. There would be a little over a month break before new episodes were released for the second series on Halloween of 1964. Now, in this story, the TARDIS lands in the midst of the French Revolution in the time known as the Reign of Terror. It's interesting as the four find themselves swept up in events that will eventually lead to the installation of Napoleon Bonaparte. Now, in watching this, I came to one conclusion when it comes to these historicals. While they are interesting and they do allow one to explore history, story-wise, they don't do much as far as our heroes are concerned, because they cannot change anything and are more just trying to escape from whatever situation they manage to get themselves into. And you can see it from the cavemen, to Marco Polo, to the Aztecs, and now this. It's the one conceit the new series does do well, as any time the Doctor meets with historical figures, he is part of the story, as there is always an alien element to the historical story. He can't leave until he resolves it, rather than him just trying to escape and avoid damaging the timeline. Now, I'm going to admit, I'm not very versed in the French Revolution, so I found this even more interesting with the intrigue as the four get caught up in the machinations of Robespierre, the revolutionaries, and the counter-revolutionaries. Napoleon even makes a cameo in this story. Now, if you recall, in the last story, the Doctor was offended by a statement of Ian's, and he threatened to put the two off the ship at the next stop. I did like how they were able to assuage the Doctor's feelings a little and get him to accompany them outside the TARDIS to just make sure everything was all right before taking off. Now, even though we didn't get much of it in the series, I always shipped Ian and Barbara, and there's a moment when they realize they are not home. Ian takes Barbara's hand, and the whole time they speak, they are only looking at each other. It's a really nice touch. You know, in fact, there are many things to love about this story, including the cliffhanger of the Doctor trapped in the fire in the first episode. Now, in the second episode, though, there's some risque business for Barbara. The guard who's watching over her comes on to her and offers her the chance at freedom if she's friendly. You know, the story on the DVD that they have in one of the documentaries about Hartnell's double, making sure he moved like Hartnell, was really funny too. Because here you had scenes of Hartnell's doctor walking in what's supposed to be rural France, and instead they got the body double to do it instead. Now, I know it annoyed Hartnell to be watched the way he was, but when you watch the scenes of the Doctor's double walking through the rural areas of France, it lended such credibility to those scenes. And we also get some cool exterior footage, the first for the series. I love the scene with Barbara and Susan in the cell, because after all this time, you would have thought that maybe the two of them together, they might have gotten a little despondent. But no, Barbara just shows just how resourceful she is, and she doesn't give in to despair as easily as even Susan does. I love the scene of the Doctor meeting the workers on the road and then him being collared into helping them. And then we get to the third episode, where we've got this opening with Hartnell walking through the streets of Paris. Now, on the one hand, it is clearly impressive what they had to work with, from the change in Lime Grove to the television center there. I think that's where they went to, because they were doing the most of the first season in Lime Grove. And there was always talk about the difficulties in working with Lime Grove. But when you see just how expanded this city set is for the Reign of Terror, you really come to appreciate that as difficult as Lime Grove was, they made it work. And there's just some great visuals, like the Sensorite ship, the Dalek city, even the interior of the TARDIS. So, you know, kudos to them. In this third episode, we're also introduced to Edward Brayshaw, who makes his first appearance on Doctor Who as Leon Colbert. Now, you may not recognize him from the looks on his face, but when you hear that distinctive voice, you know that that is the War Chief from the later epic Patrick Troughton story, The War Games. And then we come to the fourth and fifth episodes. Now, these are the two that are actually missing from the series. So the BBC commissioned an animation team to create animation based on the audio that does remain of these two episodes. Right off the bat, I already like the animation better than the recent Power of the Daleks. There's more depth to the faces. The only problem with it overall is that the director took a lot of liberties, and I mean the director of the animation. He took a lot of liberties with these two segments because he varies the shots way too much. It's sort of a little jarring at first. You get used to it quickly, but when you're used to the more open and stark angles where maybe you might have one on Barbara, one on Ian, suddenly, like, this director decided to really go crazy and do some variations of animation angles, styles, and such that just was too much. But otherwise, yeah, this animation is so much better than Power of the Daleks. And then we come back to the live action of the sixth episode. And I got to admit, I love the simplicity, the idea of Ian and Barbara being innkeepers and, you know, routing the whole thing and everybody getting back together and making their way off with that really cool ending as the Doctor talks about going out and exploring the stars. So where does this take us for the series finale? I place this story about midway in my top list. The way it works out is this. Number one, Marco Polo. Number two, the Daleks. Number three, the Aztecs. Number four, An Unearthly Child. Number five, The Reign of Terror. Six is The Edge of Destruction. Seven, The Keys of Marinus. And finally, eight, The Sensorites. So there you have it. The first series concluded. Fear not, though. I won't take as long as the second series did to come back with new reviews, which really wasn't that long compared to current Doctor Who these days. The TARDIS has a malfunction that causes it and the travelers to shrink in size and wind up in modern-day London and dealing with a murder mystery. Stay tuned for Planet of the Giants, the story that was actually supposed to be the very first Doctor Who story, and we'll get into that in our next review. Until then, folks, thank you so much for listening. Remember, head on over to chronicriff.com or the Chronic Riff Facebook page and let us know what you think of Doctor Who and Mr. Drew and all the other great programs we have over on the Chronic Riff Network. So until next time, everyone, take care.
Our lives are important, at least to us. And as we see, so we learn.
And what are we going to see and learn next, Doctor?
But unlike the old adage, my boy, our destiny is in the stars. So let's go and search for it.